Good morning. Is Dr. Oza here? Or? He's the, one, the first speaker. Okay. Just a moment. So we'd like to start. Sorry for the delay. We are still waiting for Dr. Lee Herzenberg to come. But we should get started. Today is a beautiful day, and it's a cherry blossom is over. And I would like to congratulate Dr. Len Herzenberg and Lee Herzenberg for training such a large number of very impressive list of many young investigators, who is not so young anymore after. Or I may still be young. I'm very honored to meet many of you and also have an opportunity to introduce some of you to this session. My name is Kenichi Arai. I'm a member of the Institute of Medical Science, University of Tokyo, formerly or still maybe associated with DINAX Research Institute, as well as some of the Stanford activity. I and my wife, Naoko, who is participating here, joined Stanford 15 years ago at the same third floor of the medical center, but not in the genetics department, but in biochemistry department. I worked, my wife and I worked with Arthur Kornberg since 1977. Both Department of Genetics as well as biochemistry are very stimulating each other, sometimes fight each other. And Ab Weizmann was the second floor, so we enjoyed all the atmosphere of open Stanford, California. And I am very happy to see this will be again visualized here. And also, I'd like to appreciate Lee and Herzenberg and also Len Herzenberg for very kind help to establish DINAX Research Institute during the 1980s. And they are always kind to us and share many interesting results. This morning, I'd like to start by introducing Dr. Harvey Oza. It's very difficult to pronounce it, and I made sure that this is Oza, that is fine. And his thank you. Theme is not on immunology, but more on the cell transformation. And the title of his talk is "Immortality at What Price: Aging versus Cancer." Dr. Oza, please.
As everyone who has spoken before me, it's a great pleasure to be here. I like to put my being here in some perspective. Also, the person who addressed you first among the former students was Roy Riblett, and Roy pointed out that he was the first doctoral student in the laboratory. Before Roy came on the scene, there was a group of medical students who were his, Lee and Len's first students, and in fact, I was technically the very first student to enter the laboratory in 1960. And so I'm proud to say that I am his first student. In fact, there was several of us of me are here, and you've met them or know them, and that's specifically Bob Erickson came in very soon after that. Irv Weissman was there for a brief time, and John Wunderlich. And then later on, again within a period of about 3 years, John Minna and Randy Greep, who aren't here, joined. So really, there was a large cluster of medical students before the graduate students started on the scene. The other thing that's rather striking about it is that a high percentage of us actually went into research, not only into research, but into full-time research. Irv doesn't do any clinical work. I don't do any clinical work. John Wunderlich doesn't do any clinical work. And Bob does both clinical work and is a very successful researcher. So he obviously had a tremendous impact on our career development. And in my own case, it was even more than that, because I came to Stanford intending to take an advanced degree in sociology and to go into public health. And so I can literally say he totally changed my interests and my orientation, and is responsible for my going on in science. And I can never forget that. And I really have the very warmest and deepest feelings for you and Lee, and I'm happy to be able to say that publicly at this time. At that time, also, the laboratory wasn't as totally committed to immunology. Well, it's never been totally committed to anything, I think. That's the best way of putting it. But there was an interest in somatic cell genetics, and that was, in fact, immunology came in, the H2, as a model of somatic cell genetics. And in a sense, I've continued in that area of interest, although my own research has diverged greatly from that time. And so I'd like to talk somewhat about using the approaches of cell genetics as we have to get at various problems. The other thing is really in way of final introductory comment is befitting the fact of my own being the oldest student if, by longevity, if not by age, I think maybe even by age for that matter, but also Len's new rebirth that we talk, the talk will be about cellular aging of mine and Len's immortality in his rebirth. So with that, I'd like to start the talk. And in fact, what is cellular aging? In fact, if you put cells in culture, they're called primary cells, and we know what that is, but even cells that have been in culture very briefly, few passages, and then you passage them repeatedly, and what I'm going to be talking about fundamentally are fibroblasts, they go along fine, they can be divided, they passaged at weekly intervals, and then for some obscure reason, they stop growing. And in fact, it was noted by first by Hayflick that if you take cells that come from older individuals, they grow a shorter period of time than cells from younger individuals. And so as if there were some sort of a clock going on. And that led to the idea that there might be a phenomenon of aging which could be studied at the cellular level. And that's where we came into the story in terms of trying to use this as a model for cellular growth. One way of studying cellular aging is actually to ask what reverses it, what overcomes it, and that's what I'm going to really be talking about. Because the term that we say when we overcome cellular aging is that things become immortal. If I have the first slide. And I'd like to contrast the behavior of human cells with the more commonly studied rodent cells because there are some differences. As I say, and here we're talking about human embryo fibroblasts, they can grow for about 50 to 60 generations, at which point this phenomenon of growth arrest takes place. The thing that is extraordinarily striking is that there has been no report of spontaneous immortalization, or very, very rare reports of spontaneous immortalization of human fibroblasts. Now, that's to be contrasted to tumors, which, of course, are often immortal. And so, but there are no normal immortal human fibroblast cell lines. This is really in very striking contrast to the rodent system. There they go fewer generations before the onset of so-called senescence or growth arrest. However, they can spontaneous immortalize, and that's a lot of the fibroblast cell lines that we all work with, like 3T3 or CHO or whatever. But even more, if you put in a class of oncogenes, in the old terminology, the A type, examples being polyoma large T, or activated c-MYC, these will in fact increase the rate of immortalization to virtually 100%. So in fact, it's very easy to get immortals, and that's in fact an assay for these oncogenes. On the other hand, if you put these same oncogenes into human fibroblasts, not only don't they immortalize, but very often you can't see any phenotypic effects of that. So this suggested that maybe the inability or the resistance of human fibroblasts to immortalization might have some interesting biological basis. Well, in order to get at this, we decided to look at the one thing that seemed to work in both systems. And that's something that, in fact, I had been working on up to that point, which is a small DNA virus, SV40. SV40 readily immortalizes human fibroblasts and rarely immortalizes human fibroblasts. And we thought that it would be useful to compare the interaction of SV40 in the two systems as a way of getting at the basis for the phenomenon. As an aside, one should point out that SV40 actually grows and kills human fibroblasts. So everything I'm going to be talking about has a small deletion in the origin of DNA replication of SV40, so there is no DNA replication or virus replication in any of the constructs that we're talking about. So everything is done by transfection as a result. Well, what we did was we transfected, therefore, an origin-defective wild-type SV40 genome into human fibroblasts. And the human fibroblast I'm going to be talking about this morning is a fetal bone marrow stromal fibroblast, the significance of which is unclear, and we just started with it for no good reason. Can I have the next slide? We transfected it that in and isolated an individual transformant. We've done this many times. This is the lifespan of HS74. You can passage it weekly, then it slows down, and finally you can't passage it anymore. These cells, by the way, are not dead. They will persist in protein synthesis. If you transfect and pick a clone and passage that, you see that very clearly the cells grow longer, but a similar sort of phenomenon comes along. Problem with terminology, this is called crisis, that's called senescence. It's not clear if they're the same thing. So in any case, what clearly is the case, that SV40 transformation does not result in immortalization. Rather, it results in an extension of lifespan. If you did the same experiment in rodent cells, the cultures would grow continuously. Can I have the next slide? However, SV40 transformation increases the likelihood of immortalization from essentially undetectable to some value. So even though 100% of the cells are showing viral gene expression, only a very small percentage become immortal. In some transformers, the frequency is undetectable, less than 10 to the minus 8. In others, the frequency is very, very high. Typically, the frequency is about 10 to the minus 6 to 10 to the minus 7. And here's this particular cell line that we used. So for reasons that we don't yet understand, the frequency varies considerably with the individual transformer. However, as I said, we can get immortals now, whereas we couldn't before. And so we can just ask very simply, well, what's different about the immortals? The simplest hypothesis is the immortal was always there, and it just took time to grow out. We had to kill off all the non-immortal cells so we could see it. Can I have the next slide? And that would make a very simple prediction. It should be a good grower, and it's not. This is some of the growth parameters of the normal cell we started with at early passage. It has a good cloning efficiency, a reasonable doubling time, and a saturation density compatible with normal cells. The transformant that we isolated is not a better grower than the normal, and it's very similar. And it has a high saturation density, showing its transformed parameters. And these are a series of 6 independent immortals that were isolated from this particular transformant. And if you scan the list, you see it varies. They certainly have lower as well as higher efficiencies of cloning. Their doubling times are either greater or lesser than the starting material. So clearly, they're not a better grower at the time they become immortal. That's to be contrasted with what people normally look at, which is immortal cell lines that have been long passage. Indeed, there's a strong selection for better growers once they become immortal. And that's very easily shown here, where at early passage, it's not better than the starting material. But if you passage it many times, it becomes better. So the bottom line is that better growth is not a necessary aspect of immortalization. Well, what is? And so we looked at a large number of parameters. The next slide summarizes some of them in keeping with my background. We looked at a number of surface antigens. We found some went up, some went down, never correlated with immortalization. There were more changes in transformation than immortalization. Growth factors were produced. Again, we couldn't link it to immortalization. The most obvious thing to look at intensively, because it's quite frankly the easiest, is the SV40 genome. The simplest model is that the viral genes become better expressed. In the case of SV40, that's a very simple problem, because in fact, there are only 2 proteins that are coded for by the viral genome that are expressed in these cells, large T, as it's called, and small t. And the role of small t is obscure and seems to make large T do better. So really, it comes down to one multifunctional protein. So it's easy to assess that. And these transformants and immortals, because of the fact that we started with an origin defective, have only a single integrated copy of 2 integrated copies. So it's very easy to study rearrangements, things of the sort. So we looked for rearrangements. We found some. We looked for amplification. We found some. We looked for levels of T protein. They don't change. The rearrangements, if there are rearrangements, there's a constant copy which is not being rearranged. That's the copy that's expressing the RNA, which is leading to the T antigen in these cells. So all these changes in the viral genome, none of which are terribly dramatic, apparently have nothing to do with immortalization. So we decided to look a little more closely at the role of T antigen by generating immortals which encoded a heat labile T antigen, so-called TSA transformants. Now, again, all the results that I've set up to this point apply to there as well. No difference if we do everything at 35 degrees. But the T antigen clearly is playing a role not only in facilitating the event of immortalization, but actually in maintaining immortalization. And that can be shown most simply by doing a growth curve at the two temperatures. If I have the next slide. If you grow TSA transformant, and this is TSAA, as we call it, at 35 degrees, it grows with a reasonable doubling time. If you shift up to 39 degrees, the cells, cell number does not increase anymore, and then the cells die. And this is independent of the cell density at which you do this. So T antigen may not be sufficient, but it's necessary both for the initiation and the maintenance of the immortalization using the old virological terminology. Well, how is it doing that? Well, fortunately, we have some understanding of the way T antigen affects cells. And a major way it affects it is to complex with the so-called tumor suppressor gene products, retinoblastoma susceptibility protein, or RB, and P53. And so a logical model would be that the way that SV40 transforms and maintains the immortalized behavior of these cells is through its interaction in RB by complexing to RB, and it activates RB by complexing to P53, and it activates P53. So we looked at whether there was complex formation. You could have the next slide. This was done by simple immune precipitation followed by Western immunoblotting. Extracts were made from the cell line. This is an immortal cell line nicknamed HAL, no connection with 2001. Extracts were made at 35 degrees or 39 degrees for 3 days. The extracts were then immune precipitated with antibody to T antigen, and the immune precipitates were then analyzed by Western immune blot and developed with antibody to T antigen. And lane one is at 35 degrees, lane two is at 39 degrees. You can see the T antigen is made at both temperatures. If you did the immune precipitation with anti-RB and stained for T, you see that there is some T brought down with the anti-RB. Not that much, but there is some. And at 39 degrees, there's much less. And if control antibodies are used, you don't see anything. So this suggested that, in fact, there were TRB complexes. You could do the reciprocal experiment to get the same sort of results. A subpopulation of T is bound to RB. Some of the RB is bound to T at 35 degrees. There's less at 39 degrees. This is a wild-type cell line that most of you are familiar with, Koch cells, made actually with a similar construct. And you can see, therefore, a subpopulation is T is complex to RB at both temperatures, but it's undifferent. We looked at P53. Have the next slide. And you get the same result. The order of the precipitates are different. Here is immune precipitation with anti-P53. It brings down, at 35 degrees, it brings down P53 plus T. At 39 degrees, it brings down P53, but does not bring down T. The reason for this lower level is that T stabilizes P53 in these types of cell lines. And this is a non-temperature sensitive transformant, which makes a truncated T, and you can see it's got good complexes at both temperatures. And the failure to do this is dependent on the T, because if you put in a wild-type genome, in fact, you restore P53 binding in the cell at both temperatures. So one simple explanation as to what's going on is that T is complexing to these proteins. It's necessary for T to carry out its effect. When you shift to 39 degrees, the complexes no longer exist. The cells now stop growing. To get support for that and to look at the relative role of each of these, we decided to try to put back in something that could restore binding of P53 or RB. If we put back wild type, we restore it, but of course we restore everything. So it's a nice control, but it doesn't tell us what we want to know. We decided initially to focus on RB because someone else, Gretchen Stein specifically, had shown that phosphorylation of RB was aberrant in senescent cells, and so there was a precedent for believing that overriding that block would be relevant in human fibroblasts. And so we did the next experiment, shown the next slide. We took advantage of the fact that polyoma large T binds RB but does not bind P53. So using an amphotropic retrovirus vector, we introduced polyoma large T, showed that it bound RB at both temperatures. But when you do the growth curve, it didn't correct the defect. This is HAL cells, 35 it grows, 39 it doesn't. Transfected with wild-type SV40, it grows at both temperatures. Transfected with polyoma large T, it grows at 35, still doesn't grow at 39. Put in adeno E1A, which also binds RB but not P53, again, grows at 35, doesn't grow at 39 degrees. So restoring RB doesn't seem to be the whole story, although it's probably maybe part of the story. And the simplest explanation is we have to restore both RB and P53. So now we're putting P53 binding constructs or P53 mutants into these cell lines. So if I have the next slide, the conclusion that we came to was that, in fact, introduction of SV40 led to transformation, and indeed, immortalization occurred subsequently, but it can't be due to the SV40 because the studies that I just described to you, again, the behavior is the same in the pre-immortal and the mortal. So everything that we look at with SV40 doesn't really change. So we're drawn to the idea that there must be a cellular change, which is not necessarily T-dependent, but is just allowed to occur because of the expanded cell population or the fact that T is mutagenic. Well, how to look for the difference? Well, one approach that we're using that I'm not going to talk about, we've made cDNA libraries from the immortals and the pre-immortals, and we're comparing them by subtractive hybridization. But there's a simpler experiment that one can do, which has worked over and over again in other systems. Let's look at the karyotype. Now, in fact, if anyone has worked with SV40 immortalized human cells, you've been told, and correctly, that the karyotypes are abysmal. So that's really a dumb experiment to do. But we decided, what the hell, we'll take a look. And when we looked at the karyotype of this cell, which is the starting material, as it were, we got a very pleasant surprise. You have the next slide? It's a normal diploid, even though it's SV40 transformed, except that it's only got one copy of 16. So that encouraged us to look at the immortals to see if we could find something that was a limited change. And can I have the next slide? This is a tetraploid. The fact that it's a tetraploid is not relevant. The diploid shows it's a mixture population. This figure came out better. It's still got only 116, and this particular transformer gave immortals at a high frequency. So this is an uncloned population of immortals. You can see that there's a translocation between here and here. There's something added on here. It's not, too many changes. What I want to call your attention is that there's a break here. The region distal to 6Q21 is missing. Well, we have, in fact, a number of immortals that came from that particular transformant. We have the one that led to this. You can have the next slide. That's this one. Now, summarizing the data, the transformant, you see, is essentially only abnormalities of minus 16. This gave immortals such a high frequency that just blind passage of the pre-immortal led to the immortals taking over. And we see we're looking at an early passage where there are even some of the pre-immortals still around. And you can see that they have a limited number of changes, as I pointed out. If we clone this cell and analyze that, it's preserved some of the changes that were present before. If we look at a series of cloned immortals that were developed from this cell line independently of this lineage, we find that it also has a limited number of immortals. It comes from the same material, it's still minus 16. It shares some of the changes with some of the others. It has some changes which are lineage dependent, like this is seen in this lineage, it's not seen in this lineage. This is seen in this lineage, it's not seen in that lineage. But there's only two things that they all share. One is they're all hemizygous for 16. The other is they're all deleted for the long arm of chromosome 6. All the immortals are deleted for the long arm of chromosome 6. So the only common denominator is deletion of sequences along arm of chromosome 6. It is deletion of sequences. We do quantitative Southerns looking at oncogenes, which are distal 6q21, not because we think that they may be important, but because they're probes easily available. You find that you have half the dosage of CMIB, for example, ROS, and MAS. There's an easy way to follow the sequences, though, and that's to use one of the highly polymorphic repeat sequences, the dinucleotide repeats, CA or GT repeats. And fortunately, there's one at 6q23. So we looked at that as a convenient way of following the long arm of chromosome 6. And kind of the next slide. This is HS74. It's got two alleles for this particular polymorphism. These are two passages, early passages of the transformant. This is the uncloned immortal. And this is HAL, which is cloned and comes from this. So it confirms the cytogenetics, it confirms the quantitative Southerns. And in fact, we've got hemizygosity, loss of heterozygosity of something in the long arm of 6. That all fits. These are three passages of the AR5 independent immortal that came from this. And it also has everything that I just said. The only trouble is it's got a different allele. Now, that raises some interesting questions, which I'd be happy to talk about later. But the trivial explanation has been a crossover between the gene that we're really trying to follow and this polymorphic marker. But it raises questions whether gene dosage might be rather important as well. And for example, only halving the dosage of 6, of a gene on 6, is important. Well, if that's the case, immortalization should be very readily obtained, because all you have to do is knock out a single gene and single copy. So that can't be the explanation on its own. That's too frequent. So it might be a combination of losses of gene dosage. So I don't know what else is going on, so to speak, but I would argue that something important is going on in 6. Now, if that were true, and if you realize that immortalization is actually recessive to limited lifespan, which is not what people normally think. So it really is consistent with the double knockout model that I'm talking about as classical tumor suppressor loss. But if you do that, then there's a very simple prediction. If we put in a normal chromosome 6, we should suppress growth. Now, if I can have the next slide. Fortunately, a colleague in the department, Ravi Atwal, has developed a series of monochromosomal cell lines. So he has rodent cells with single human chromosomes in them. And he has one that has a single copy of human chromosome 6. And moreover, it's marked with something that you've already heard about, and if you didn't know before, Laura Leckhout mentioned, it's got PSV2 GPT in it. So it has a dominant selectable marker on the human X, I mean on the human 6. So we can introduce that and select for it. The better way to do it, other than making hybrids, because it's in a rodent cell and we'd lose the human chromosomes, is to do microcell fusion. So in essence, the cell line RA6 is treated with colsimid, lead to abortive mitoses, and one can then, using cytochalasin, make microcell preparations, which would have varying numbers of rodent chromosomes, and either will or will not have the human chromosome 6, which is marked with GPT. And we can fuse that with our immortal cell lines. Because of something that will be relevant later, HAL is not only a subclone of TSA, it's an HPRT-minus subclone of TSA. And we also made it resistant to G418 by introducing RSV-neo. So it's multiply marked. This allows us to do the experiment in G418, so it eliminates any possibility of intact cells coming through the procedure in this way. Oops, could I go back to the old one? No, back to the previous slide. Thank you. So essentially, we fused these microcells with HAL-NEO. We selected a microphenolic plus xanthine for GPT expression, and we should get hybrids. Now, what should be the result? Well, if it works out perfectly, we should introduce human 6, and human 6 should suppress growth, and we shouldn't get any hybrids. So the perfect result is a failure. Because how do we distinguish that from the fact the experiment didn't work in the first place? So then you take advantage of a very dedicated postdoc in Atwal's lab. You do this experiment, but you look at every dish. And you look at them every week. And you look for abortive colonies, look for colonies that start to grow but then stop growing. And Arban Sindhu did such an experiment six times, and we found five colonies that did that. If you introduce another chromosome like chromosome 2, you get nice hybrids and they grow vigorously. So it's some specificity. Fortunately, there was one colony that grew, and it grew long enough that you could actually trypsinize it, respread it, and make some DNA, and the CA repeat polymorphism is a PCR-based technology, so you can actually isolate DNA and analyze the material. And when you do that, you get the following result. Do you have the next slide? Okay, here is Hal Neo's CA repeat. Here's the donor 6. And here's DNA made from the hybrid, the putative hybrid. So in fact, it's GPT plus. It's growing in, it was isolated and maintained in mycophenolic plazanthine, so it had to have GPT, and it's got the CA repeat that's characteristic of the donor 6. So it looks like it really is compatible with a microcell hybrid. But you can do another thing. We can also take, because we could trypsinize it, we could put them into microwells, we could also take away the selection of the mycophenolic plazanthine, selection for the GPT. We could actually put them, after some period of time, into thioguanine, which now back-selects against the donor 6, and therefore should back-select against suppression. And in fact, when you do that, you do get a colony growing out. You do get a segregant, and it's lost the donor 6. It's retained only the Hal Neo. So from, though this is very limited data because of the vagaries of the system, it appears that, in fact, the rearrangement on 6 has some biological significance by virtue of the gene transfer experiments. Now, obviously, we're not talking about a gene at this point, but a region of thousands of genes. So if I can have the next slide. This is what the Hal Neo looks like, just for reference. It's a flat fibroblastoid cell. Have the next one. This is what the suppressed, putative suppressed hybrid. They look like 6 cells, but unfortunately that's what senescence looks like, 6 cells. So I'm not, so at least the morphology is compatible. If I have the next slide. So I'd like to end by leading you to a couple of conclusions that I hope I've convinced you of in the course of the presentation. And one is that immortalization is a multi-step phenomenon. And that may simply explain why it's so hard to get immortal spontaneously. In the case of SV40, SV40 T antigen is necessary but not sufficient, and the T antigen, I believe, is functioning mainly as a mitogen, which it's well known to do, and that's most obvious in the extended lifespan, and that need for the extent, those same functions which are responsible for extended lifespan are also needed to maintain the immortalized phenotype in the immortalized cell. However, the additional change, and there may be more than one of them, involves an inactivation of a gene, which logically might be the same one which induced senescence in the first place. So it really fits the tumor suppressor type model, a growth suppressor type model that I would leave you with. I should say there's a limited number of all these genes. People have done complementation analysis. Virtually all the SV40 transformants fail to complement each other, whereas they do complement another type of immortal-like HeLa cells. So that, in fact, 4 complementation groups have been developed by cell fusion experiments. So I would say that a particular senescent gene is inactivated in these things. A couple of asides, origin-defective SV40 genomes are particularly effective in generating immortal cell lines, and maybe the TSA construct is particularly useful in getting cells with minimum karyotypic abnormalities. We have other transformants which similarly have minimal. And if I go to the next slide. Actually, what I didn't talk about is trying to understand senescence by all this other than to identify the possible location of a gene. And I should say that when we shift up even pre-immortals, we can restore senescence, and so it might be a way of synchronously inducing senescence. And of course, these cells have allowed us to develop matched genetic lines. And could I have the next one? I don't have to stress the value of here. Have the next slide, please. And I'd like to acknowledge collaborators and members of my laboratory. Krishna Jha has been a long-term associate with me and Karen Hubbard-Smith is a more recent associate, both of whom hold research positions. These are three graduate students and two former graduate students. And the cytogenetics was done in collaboration with Ann Henderson, who's at Hunter College, where I used to be, and Phil Pasalis is a graduate student in her lab. And he was responsible for much of the cytogenetics, well, all of the cytogenetics. Raghbir Akbal, I mentioned, and Mike Small is a former graduate student who's collaborated on the cDNA libraries and other things that I haven't talked about in mortal cells. So I thank you for your attention. And I trust you will be immortal in the best sense of the word, and this is not a prelude to cancer.
Thank you very much, Dr. Odder.
Yeah. I don't know is the easiest way. I believe that it may be. And the reason is this particular transformant, as I said, transformants give you immortals at various frequencies. It's reproducible. I mean, it's not the vagaries of the system. Why did this one give it at a high frequency? And if you take the argument that this different sixes are lost in each case, I've got to come up with another explanation. So, in fact, what we're doing now is screening all our immortals that were independently derived and getting immortals from other labs for RFLPs on 16, and as well as 6, and seeing whether we can show that there's a predictive value as to whether there's a 6. The other possibility is that it's not 16 and it is fortuitous. And then the alternative is that possibly the integration site of the SV40 genome has some relevance. And lo and behold, this is on 5Q near the polyposis locus. So we're trying to actually now map more. That's based on in situ hybridization. So we're now trying to map more carefully whether it, in fact, is in a key region. But we have to have some other explanation. Yeah.
So do you see a dosage expression?
Not really. So I'd have to say that it's either that the thinking about 5 or 16 are really having to work on a dosage type model. And I've had a lot of trouble with thinking that half dosage makes that much difference. But in talking around, if you start thinking in terms of multi-enzyme interactive systems like transcription factor, you know, the magic word of the period, indeed it's not far-fetched, but I must say I'd be surprised to believe that there's a lot of genes that are being half-dosed, and that's the explanation. That's right. It's a very different phenomenology and may, in fact, it undoubtedly has to do with what the viral genes do to cells. We don't know what part of T or whether it's a specific domain of T which is responsible for the chromosome damage. But T is such a multifunctional protein that interferes with virtually every level of molecular biology and cell biology. It's not surprising that it might generate a lot of chromosome breaks. But nobody has, in fact, worked it out what it is. So I think it's probably a toxic effect, quote unquote, of the T, or the T's effect on destabilizing the genome. And that's in quotation marks with very vague connotation. The TSA is different because I would say it has probably a functional low T even at the permissive temperature. I don't know what it's due to. Now, there is some gene expression that goes on in those, and there has been a gene which is responsible for the transformation. But the immortalization may well be due to the expression of a specific growth factor, and I think that's been argued, and that would only require one of the many functions that these things could do. There hasn't been a specific growth factor that's been identified. So.
Before I ask one more question. Can you use the microphone?
Yeah. push the other.
Some years back, we attempted to make a hybridoma for a bovine fusion partner and used two bovine leucosis virus cell lines, nature transformation unknown. And when they were made HAT sensitive and fused to normal bovine leukocytes that were activated appropriately, they remained quiescent for up to periods of several months while they lost chromosomes and did not start replicating until they returned to the original chromosome cell number. Our impression was that the immortalization procedure there was being suppressed by any gene product of any introduced chromosome from normal cow cells, as opposed to being a specific product on a particular chromosome.
We don't, as I say, we don't know the mechanism here, but I suggest it's probably different because the work, especially of Pereira Smith and Jim Smith, Olivia Pereira Smith and Jim Smith in Texas, was to do the similar sort of experiment with different immortals, for example. And under those conditions, they could be ordered into four complementation groups. And as I said, virtually all the SV40 transformants, immortal cells, including ours, fell into a particular group. And there are other members in that group that had nothing to do with SV40, although there were only a few of them. And they've done similar experiments in terms of the microcell fusion and with HeLa cells. And they find that chromosome 4 suppresses growth, mortality, whatever, in HeLa cells. Now, they didn't test 6, and we've not tested 4, but they did rule out several other chromosomes. So there seems to be some specificity in this situation.
Comment from, you don't need.
Just a small question. Did you check whether these immortalized cell lines are tumorigenic in immunodeficient mice and whether the varied fused hybrids or microcell fused hybrids lost that capacity?
Yeah, there's a hooker in the system. The answer is no. There's a hooker in the system. SV40 transformed human cells do not make tumors in nude mice. So it really has to be an active collaboration with someone who's done it. So that's really have not tried. They've been put into nude mice. They don't make tumors, even the starting material. It's not an easily doable experiment. It's not clear what that's due to.
How? Yes. Okay.
I would predict if you suppress immortalization, you'll suppress tumor genesis. That's the converse.
Actually, your system is anyway in vitro senescence system. Anyway, in vitro system, but nobody has the in vivo system. But recently, Dennis Delina in genetic, map the recessive trait of the Werner syndrome of human to the chromosome 8. And do you have any idea?
There are people who argue that the Werner syndrome has a lot of features that mimic a premature senescence type phenomenology, both in vivo and in vitro. But the relationship of those to even senescence, I think, is somewhat unclear. Although there are people who believe it's a good model, I have no objections with that as a model. There are also cDNA libraries that have been screened for that, and people have found differences between Werner syndrome and young or normal fibroblasts things. But the significance of all these is unclear at this point.
More comment or questions? Three.
Not apparently. People have tried those sort of things. If you can extend the lifespan, for example, by manipulating the media, but a few generations, but nothing very dramatic. And a lot of work was done a long time ago, so that one might want to look back at some of that, perhaps. But nothing very dramatic. Similarly, I would say people have not looked as hard in terms of the growth factors that are being produced by some of these cell types. I should alert you to the fact that fibroblasts may be different from others. And in one case, I think it was endothelial cells, there's a clear correlation with, I think, IL-1 and immortalization type phenotype. And you can, by using antisense, To IL-1, you can initiate senescence at any time along the way. Yeah. So that's not our work, but. It's out of respect. No. Actually, it's not. Yeah. Actually, there's a fundamental question as to what is senescence in the first place, and whether it's terminal differentiation or something else. And the inability to respond appropriately or efficiently to stress of one sort or another is actually a very valid way of looking at the whole phenomenon. So there's a lot of, that makes what you're saying quite reasonable.
Some comment on it? If not, thank you very much for your interesting presentation. The next speaker is Dr. Gary Noran. On his personal data set, I am a postdoc. I don't have a life outside of the laboratory, so I'd like to hear more about your real life in the laboratory. The title of his talk is NF kappa B and I kappa B. Rels, anchorings, and the marriage of a convenience. Gary?
So while it is a very great pleasure to be here and to honor Len and all of the contributions that he's made, it also is a great opportunity and an unparalleled opportunity to make fun of Len. So I will do that just momentarily. So I joined the lab about, I think it was 1983, and began working with Hironaka Uchi on the cloning of LYT2 and the characterization of LYT2. At one point, I had a great opportunity to go to the Pasteur to on sabbatical with Len and Lee. And my reason for being there ostensibly was to work on the facts, but I actually did a lot of their laundry and prepared dinner sometimes as well. one of the things that Len and Lee were there to do was to set up the fax facility and to get it running. And we managed actually to eventually get the cell sorter running, but this was a new fax that was being used, and Len really hadn't seen it, and it was the FaxStar, okay? And Len wanted me to teach him how to use the FaxStar. And so late one night we began, and it was getting too late. I said, all right, Len, well, let's just start early in the morning. So we went home. The next day I came in at 10 o'clock. Len had arrived 1 hour earlier, and in typical Len fashion had figured that he could do it all himself and didn't need me to show him how to get things going. Now, we'd had a lot of problems with pressure, the pressure coming from a problem with the pumps and inadequate filtration. We start with the dirty Parisian water. Not even the Parisians will drink their own water. Inadequate filtration system, and we had two filters here, a nylon filter and a cellulose filter. This was the pre-filter. Well, we couldn't get enough pressure, or Len couldn't get enough pressure. So without consulting me, he decided that it would be best just to take out this nylon filter. And lo and behold, yes, when you take out the nylon filter, the pressure went way up. I didn't know that when I arrived, and I started setting up the machine. And for some reason, the nozzle kept on getting clogged. And I went into the nozzle and looked in and pulled out all these little bits of cellulose. And I said, what's going on? Well, it turned out when I finally found out that he had taken this out, the pressure of the filter here was pushing all the cellulose through here into this very complex and expensive fluidic system and eventually ending up here. Well, Len was subsequently kicked out of the fax room, banished forever, never allowed to touch. And to make sure that he didn't touch it again, I let everybody at the Pasteur knew what he'd done. So although we saw a very good film yesterday about how Len did participate in the generation of flow cytometry, it's a darn good thing he's not an engineer, because we wouldn't be here today. Okay, so that's the truth. So if I could have the first slide, thank you. No, I didn't. That's just a fib. Right. So, as many people are aware, if you do any study of molecular biology these days, you always come across expanding gene families, or any given gene that you might study almost always is a member of a family of genes. In David's lab, I work on the rel ankyrin family, characterized best by NF-kappa-B and I-kappa-B. About 2 years ago, we began by cloning of the two genes which encode NF-kappa-B, P105, which is the precursor of P50, the P50 component of NF-kappa-B, P65 here, okay, and also I-kappa-B, which was cloned in somebody else's lab. I'm going to talk today about the mechanisms and a lot of the biochemistry. I have to apologize, there will be no immunology in this talk, it will be just pure biochemistry, of the mechanisms of how these factors here interact with the I-kappa-B families, which are the regulators then of the NF-kappa-B DNA binding and transcriptional activating factors. Okay, so if I have the next slide. So the model as it stands today, more or less, as it has stood now for a couple of years or several years, is that NF-kappa-B pre-exists in the cytoplasm of cells, bound to I-kappa-B, inhibitor of kappa-B activity, in an inactive form. It's a ubiquitous factor found in all types of cells, and it can be induced by a number of different signals. And I drew these very non-specifically because we really don't understand what it is which activates NF-kappa-B. We think that it's through a phosphorylation event aimed at I-kappa-B, but as Len discussed yesterday about the N-acetylcysteine inhibition of NF-kappa-B activity, there are some signaling pathways which can be turned up in N-acetylcysteine, others that cannot. We don't know enough about this right now, so I'm not going to talk about that too much. When NF-kappa-B is activated, presumably through phosphorylation and release of I-kappa-B, P50-65, the subcomponents of NF-kappa-B, translocate to the nucleus where they bind to DNA. And as I'll show you in a little while, they bind to DNA in an orientation-specific manner controlled by the differential DNA specificity of the DNA binding domains of 50 and 65. And when they bind to DNA near specific genes, they transactivate the expression of these genes. There are a number of genes which can be transactivated. The first one was IgKappa. NF-kappa-B activation was correlated first and studied first by Ranjan Shen in the lab. To be the activator of IgKappa. It will induce LPS induction of pre-B cells, will induce IgKappa transcription. It was subsequently found that TNF-alpha, IL-6, a number of other inflammatory cytokines, and HIV can all be activated when NF-kappa-B translocates to the nucleus, so there is a correlation involved here. The list actually goes on and on and on. There are about 50 genes which at this point seem to be activated by NF-kappa-B. They can be found in the brain, they can be found in epidermis, a number of different genes and a number of different cell types all seem to be activated by NF-kappa-B. Now, this leads to a number of interesting questions at the beginning. How do you manage with a single transcription factor to activate differentially all of these different genes. And so we've begun to explore some of these questions. The next slide, thank you. So I'll take a walk through history. This is the model as it stood when I first arrived in David's lab. So as I said, NF-kappa-B, the component which is known, the complex which is known as NF-kappa-B, is composed of two factors, P50 and P65. Those are just the sizes of the proteins. P50 was shown by Patrick Bowerly in the lab to contain the DNA binding specificity. It was thought to contain all of the DNA binding specificity of NF-kappa-B. P65 had no apparent DNA binding activity and was thought to be a modulatory protein which allowed I-kappa-B to interact with P50 and 65. I-kappa-B then binds as this complex in the cytoplasm. Phosphorylation or detergent dissociation was shown. This was done all in vitro. Was shown to release I-kappa-B, which would then allow this to bind. So the DNA binding conformation, as it was thought about two years ago, was that 50 contained the DNA binding. P65 sat on top, perhaps as a cofactor, or as the factor which allowed I-kappa-B to interact. Now, there was another factor found in cells, P50. P50 homodimers were also known to exist in cells and were constitutively expressed and found in the nucleus of cells. P50, subsequently shown to be the KBF1 transcription factor, which turns on H2 kappa expression, which is ubiquitously expressed. This is P50. You could add I-kappa-B to this, and it would release the DNA binding, and that's shown here. So here you have 50 and 65. There are two complexes. There's the 50 homodimer here, the 50-65 heterodimer here. In the presence of increasing amounts of I-kappa-B, you lose specifically the binding of I-kappa-B to this. So as it stood about 2 years ago, NF-kappa-B was thought to be a heterotetramer complex. The P50 was thought to be a homodimer, and I-kappa-B bound presumably through 65. Okay, so what I'm going to show you is that, in fact, we've halved the size of this complex and turned it on its side, and that the I-kappa-Bs are not always found where you expect them to be found. The next slide. So I'll show you how we have begun to build the new models. So it was necessary because all of the previous data had only been generated on the basis of purified proteins from cells to be able to clone the genes, understand what the molecular basis of their interactions are, and then also to be able to see if we could understand a little bit more about how they function using a lot more of the protein. So when we cloned, okay, so I should actually say that the proteins were cloned based, first of all, by purifying protein, getting peptide sequence, doing the reverse genetics necessary to clone out the genes using PCR technology. Shankar Ghosh in the lab cloned P50. I cloned P65. P50, in fact, the first major surprise, the first nasty surprise, was that P50 was expressed when you looked at the cDNA which encoded P50. In fact, it's capable of encoding a protein of 105 kilodalton. Now, the peptide sequence which we had all fell in this region here. In fact, it all fell, and so we had some down into here. We didn't have any of the glycine-rich region. P50, if you were to predict a size, it would truncate right in about here. So the first surprise was then that there's this extra region, which we had no idea what it was. But it does, though, contain a number of repeat sequences, which were found in erythrocyte anchorin and a number of other genes which seem to be associated with cell cycle control in yeast and Cynorhabditis. So we still didn't know what these things were, but we knew that these repeats existed. So the first conclusion was that P50 is expressed as a precursor protein, which must undergo some form of proteolysis, presumably, to generate the P50. Now, the REL homology domain, this thing here, which I've outlined here, there was another gene which had been previously cloned called CREL, which is an avian oncogene, which is capable of rapidly inducing B lymphomas in chickens. That was the main homology that was found. This REL homology domain was also found in another protein in Drosophila called dorsal, which determines the dorsal-ventral axis formation in the developing Drosophila embryo. So P50 then was linked to two previously known types of phenomena. One is developmental progression, specifying body plan, and also was linked to an oncogene. So we knew that we were onto something very interesting. It wasn't just a simple transcription factor. Okay. So then we cloned P65. The surprise was that P65 also had a REL homology domain. We weren't expecting that at all. Now, P50, if you cut off right the way down to here, all of the DNA binding and all of the dimerization, all of the ability to interact with P65, purified P65 protein, is found in this REL homology domain. You can't touch any of this 300 amino acids without destroying one or another of the functions. So the functions are interspersed across DNA binding and dimerization, are interspersed across this entire domain. P65, however, if you remember, didn't have any DNA binding capacity, at least when we used the DNA protein purified from cells. So the first conundrum was, why does P65 have an apparent domain which in another organ, in another protein can bind DNA, whereas this one cannot? So in the next slide, please. Okay, so we wanted to try to show that, first of all, these do in fact reconstitute what we think are NF-kappa B functions. So we in vitro translated the proteins. So here's a reverse, inverse orientation control. We were pleased to see, and I think Savario Alberti will also be pleased to see, that this doesn't encode P65 or TROP2 expression of any type. So this is the inverse control of P50. Okay, now if you translate just P50 alone, you get the binding complex, which you expect from P50. However, when we expressed P65, we did get an apparent DNA binding. Now, this is expressing much more protein than we ever had available to do these DNA binding studies before. So there was some weak DNA binding activity for P65. I want to just go straight here to where if you co-translate the two proteins simultaneously, you get the two expected complexes. And in fact, when you add back I-kappa B, you specifically inhibit the NF-kappa B portion, the 50-65 portion of the molecule. So what this had said was that the two proteins acted biochemically in the same way that they do when you isolate the proteins from cells. So we knew what we had was right. And in the next slide, I wanted to ask the question, now, P65, as I said before, could we focus that a little bit, please? P65 does have this REL homology domain. So I thought to myself, well, it's got to bind DNA somehow. And the reason why it mustn't bind DNA, I thought, was that there must be something down here which is preventing it from binding DNA. So we did a number of truncations, deleting off the carboxy terminal domain, and in the next slide, did a DNA binding study, again against an IG-kappa radio-labeled probe. This is a gel shift again. And what you see here is this is 5065. Here, 50. Now, this is the P65 full length, and you do a series of progressive truncations, and suddenly you truncate to the point where you release a DNA binding complex, or you enable P65 to suddenly bind DNA. What this is here, actually, is a truncation right down to the end of the REL homology domain. So there's something which is inhibitory in the carboxy terminal portion of P65, which prevents it from binding to DNA. Okay, and I'll show why that's important in a moment. Now, since P65 here bound to DNA, this gave us a great assay to attempt to map where it was that I-kappa B interacted with NF-kappa B. We had a good idea that it was interacting through 65, but in the next slide, what we can show is that I-kappa B interacts specifically through the REL homology domain of P65. So here now is using I-kappa B alpha, the protein. There are I-kappa B alpha and beta, and then subsequently gamma and a number of others, which have been discovered, so I won't go into. But here is P65 delta. That's deleted down just to the DNA binding domain. And you add progressive amounts of I-kappa B alpha. And suddenly you see that P65 DNA binding goes away. If you actually quantitate now the molar relative amounts of inhibitory protein of the inhibitory protein I-kappa B to the P65 input protein, it's actually a 1-to-1 ratio. So the stoichiometry is 1-to-1. So in the next slide, what this says is a number of things. First of all, is that P50 is basically just composed of a DNA binding and dimerization domain here. P65 is composed of a very homologous DNA binding domain here, but it has a carboxy terminal inhibitory domain. This inhibitory domain prevents efficient association of these P65 P65 homodimers, okay, you have to cleave them away. But what it does allow, though, is for 50 and 65 to associate very well and to bind to DNA. As I showed you just a moment ago, the IKappa B inhibition seems to be through P65. I don't believe anymore, this is an old slide, that it's through the DNA binding domain. I think it sits out here and allosterically inhibits the DNA binding. But we do know, though, that IKappa B interacts through the REL homology domain. And this is important because now suddenly when you realize that there are families of IKappa Bs and there are families of RELs, and these families of IKappa Bs are interacting differentially with these different RELs, then they have to, or you would imagine, that they're going to interact through something which is homologous. And so the homology domain that they're interacting with, as you'll see in a moment, are the REL homology domain. So the next slide. So what then is, what are the functions of P65? It turns out that P65 alone can transactivate HIV. So if you use an HIV reporter construct, and this reporter construct was in fact made in Len's lab, HIV promoter enhancer running LAG-Z. These are actually in the 293 cell lines. This is a stable cell line. There are two NF-kappa-B sites in the HIV LTR. P65, when transfected alone, is capable, here's no transfection, I should say here. This is the background. This is a control transfection. And when you transfect P65, you get massive induction. In fact, this isn't really a very good relative measure, but there's so much transactivation that the media goes yellow on the ONPG assay almost immediately. That, interestingly, P65 activation can be superactivated, can be overactivated by PMA. Okay? So that there's probably some modification, although this hasn't been proven yet, some phosphorylation or modification, I think, of P65, which enables it either to transactivate better or to get to the nucleus better. P65, though, can migrate to the nucleus by itself and weakly bind DNA and transactivate the HIV LTR. So one of the functions of P65 seems to be transactivation. You can use different reporter constructs just using the NF-kappa-B site, and they also will transactivate, but this is, I think, the more important slide to show. Next, please. One of the other functions of P65 actually turns out to be positioning NF-kappa-B on the DNA binding, on its DNA binding site. So here you have all these different REL binding domains. What is their function? Why are they different? Well, if you look at the NF-kappa-B site, and this here is basically the consensus NF-kappa-B site, here where you see uridine, read thymidine, it's an imperfect palindrome. Okay, you can see that these GG out here, GG, and it's an imperfect palindrome. There are other sites to which NF-kappa-B can bind which are perfect palindromes, which also fall into what is considered the consensus NF-kappa-B binding site. But the IG-kappa site, though, is GGGACTTTCC. So the question is there a specific way that NF-kappa-B sits on this DNA binding site? And in fact, the way to find this out is to use photo cross-linking probes, where you substitute here for the thymidines, which are normally here, bromodeoxyuridine. Okay, bromodeoxyuridine is a photoactivatable cross-linker. And then you add the DNA binding proteins, which you're interested in, and X and Y represent 50 or 65, and you want to ask which one is sitting where. So you bind then these proteins, this complex, to the DNA. You photo cross-link, UV cross-link, here. And then presumably, or hopefully, one or the other of the complexes will cross-link. Then you run this. In fact, I don't even run it on a gel shift. Just run it directly on a denaturing gel, SDS polyacrylamide. And this DNA probe here is radial labeled. So the piece of the complex which is not bound will, of course, fly away. But this is cross-linked covalently. And on the next slide, you can then determine which is bound to which of the different half sites. So here again, then, this we call the A half site, the B half site. Here, if you add just P50 protein, you see that it's capable of cross-linking. 65 is also capable of binding to the DNA, as I showed you before, and cross-linking. Okay, but now If you look at 5065 here, this is where we've isolated just the 5065 complex. Only 65 is capable of cross-linking here. These two bands that you see here are not this, they're background bands here. So what this says is that 50 and 65, when they bind to the DNA, next slide, thank you, they orient specifically. And they orient, that one of the functions of 65 is to orient the NF-kappa B rel complex over this half site. So what we would like to believe is that all the different rel proteins are going to be binding to different half sites, and if these different rel proteins are all heterodimerizing differentially with each other, that that will determine then the types of sites to which they can bind and the orientation to which they can bind. And if you remember, the NF-kappa B sites in HIV are actually in a specific orientation, relative, and they're always found in that specific orientation, relative to the start site of transcription. And studies are underway now to determine whether or not that orientation is a necessary orientation, because it might juxtapose the transcriptional activating domain in the right direction to the RNA polymerase start sequences. But those studies haven't been finished as of yet. The next slide, thank you. So that was some of the functions of P65. So what are the functions of P50? If you remember before, I mentioned that P50 is constitutively present in the nucleus of cells, or we think it's present in the nucleus of cells. So we wanted to see this directly by immunofluorescence. So here then are NIH3T3 cells, which have been infected with a retrovirus containing P50, using a new technique we're using in the lab to make retrovirus rapidly. This is the phase contrast. In the next slide, this now is P50, and this is, it's too bad that these lights can't go down. Sorry for the dimness of this. But if you'll believe me, these are only, P50 now is only found in the nucleus of the cell. Okay, so this confirms the findings of Alan Israel, which had said that KBF1, which is P50, is a constitutive nuclear factor which is important for expression of the H2 and probably other loci. The next slide. So we wanted to look then in vitro at the transcriptional activity of the P50 and 65 subcomponents. So this is now using extracts, HeLa nuclear extracts, and asking what is the ability of each of these subcomponents either together or apart to transactivate. And we got some interesting surprises. First of all, if you have 50 and 65 on three different types of sites, all right, IgKappa, H2, or the interferon beta site, you'll see that there is some level of similarity between each of these DNA binding sites. NF-kappa B can bind more or less, each of the subcomponents can bind more or less with equal affinity to these sites. You see that NF-kappa B, which is P50-65, is capable of transactivating all of these sites very well. P65 is also capable of transactivating, albeit weakly. And this correlates with a slightly reduced DNA binding affinity for P65. The surprise was P50. P50 was incapable, although it was incapable of inducing transcription from the interferon beta site, although it was extremely capable of inducing transcription from the H2 site. It binds with absolutely equal affinity to these two. So the explanation that it's just not binding can't be the case. So what we imagined was that when P50 binds, it's not just binding, but that it has to listen to what's going on in the DNA. So that there must be residues in P50 which touch the nucleotides in such a way that open up a DNA binding domain, which open up a transcriptional activating domain in the P50 molecule. And in fact, what Takashi Fujita in the lab was able to do was to show, and it takes too long to go through, but the conclusion is that what he was able to show was that there is a differential conformation when P50 is bound to these sites than when it's bound to these sites, and he showed it by limited proteolysis, that when P50 is bound to the H2 site, it's extremely protease resistant, but when it's bound to the interferon beta site, it's very protease sensitive. So the next slide then shows basically what we believe how P50 is acting. that when it binds to an H2 site here, or a perfectly palindromic sequence, it opens up what we think is a transcriptional activating domain. Whereas when it binds here, it is incapable of a transcriptional activating domain. So P50, in some cases, can act as a repressor. In other cases, it acts as an activator. And it all depends on the type of DNA binding site to which it binds. The story gets more complex. Next slide. When you consider that there's a large family of proteins, okay, and that, well, let me take a step back here and say that another protein was cloned in Gary Nabel's lab, P100, okay, which is very similar to P105. It also is cleaved here to release something called P49, something which seems to act, as far as we can see, similarly to P50. We can't really distinguish its activities. There's another protein, RelB, similar to P65. The transcriptional activating domains, actually, of these things appear all to be down in the carboxy terminus down here. But then we want to consider, what are the iCAPAbs doing, and how are the iCAPAbs modulating the activities of each of these? iCAPAb alpha, or MAD3, was cloned about a year or so ago. Okay, the interesting thing about iCAPAb alpha was that it also contained these ankyrin domains. Now, if you remember, P105 has ankyrin domains in its carboxy terminus. I've color-coded these ankyrin domains because even though an ankyrin domain is about 30 to 35 amino acids, and any ankyrin domain has a consensus to which you can align it, when you align all of these proteins, or each of these proteins here, what you find is that the first ankyrin domain here has more homology to any of these members than it does to any other. So the ankyrin domains here align best as genes as opposed to as random ankyrin-containing domains. So the question was, why does P105 have an apparent iCAPAb-like activity? And in fact, we never got to this when we first moved down to the Rockefeller, because suddenly we found another iCAPAb-like molecule, BCL3, when we were aligning all of the different proteins which contained iCAPAb-like or presumptive iCAPAb-like activities. So we went after this one first, and then I'll talk briefly about P105. The next slide, thank you. So what is BCL3? It was cloned about 2 years ago, almost 3 years ago now. It was discovered in a human chronic lymphocytic leukemia at it's called one of the breakpoint cluster genes. BCL3 translocates into the IGHC-alpha region. It's apparently unmolested in terms of the integrity of the gene structure, although there might be some minor modifications in this particular proto-oncogene in the cell line in which it was discovered. CLLs, as we all know, are leukemias of the LU1B lineage. It had a predicted molecular weight of 46 kilodaltons, and it contained the ankyrin repeats. And I should say that these studies are being done in collaboration with Kishor Bacha and Conrad Huffy at the NIH. So we wanted to know, was there an iCAPAb activity? And my first thought that it had iCAPAb activity against P65, and I was subsequently proven wrong through the experiments. Next slide, thank you. What it turns out is that BCL3 is not directed at P65, but in fact it's directed at P50. And the way to do this now is to take purified protein, P50, NF-kappa B, 5065, or the deletion of 65, which binds efficiently to DNA, and then to use the various inhibitors which we have and see if it inhibits the DNA binding. So we have BCL3, the I-kappa B MAD3 protein, Cactus, which is actually the Drosophila inhibitor of dorsal, so this is a control. This is another control, Notch, which is also a Drosophila ankyrin-containing protein that isn't thought to be an I-kappa B of any type, and then boiled BCL3. So what you see here is that BCL3 specifically inhibits the DNA binding of P50. It doesn't touch, apparently, NF-kappa-B, whereas iCAPAb, classically shown, inhibits NF-kappa-B but doesn't touch P50 binding. So what you have, then, are mutually exclusive inhibitory properties with the different iCAPAbs, which are the controllers of REL activity, aimed at different RELs. And in fact, what you could basically conclude from this now is that the iCAPAbs are interacting presumably through the RELs. Now, what I don't have here, I haven't brought them, the slides, is that BCL3 also inhibits P49, which is the other P50-like molecule. The next slide. So this was in vitro. We wanted to look at what are the in vivo activation potential, or whether BCL3 could interact with P50 in vivo. So if you transfect P50 along with the reporter construct, you can see transactivation of that activity. So P50 plus an IG kappa luciferase, in this case, construct, gives you activation above a control plasmid background. BCL3 is capable of inhibiting this activation here. So you see this versus this. However, in the presence of PMA, if you induce these cells, the inhibitory effect of BCL3 upon P50 is abrogated, and you begin to approach. So this is very similar to what we would have expected, that BCL3 is a controller of P50, and that it's listening to some of the signaling pathways that might be expected to affect NF-kappa B activity. The next slide. I won't go into the rest of these because it just gets a little bit too confusing right now. Next slide. Thank you. So one of the things that I wanted to do, and I'm really angry that we don't have good lighting here, I wanted to try to prove that P50 and BCL3, well, that when BCL3 and P50 were co-expressed in a cell, that P50 would then end up out in the cytoplasm. So we did studies looking at what was the nuclear localization of BCL3 and P50. And to our surprise, when we infected cells with retroviruses that expressed BCL3 alone, BCL3, which is an IKappa-B, is found in the nucleus of cells. So this basically turned on its head the whole idea that IKappa-Bs are only found in the cytoplasm. And this is, I apologize for this, but if you look here, this is a high magnification view of BCL3, and it's found exclusively in the nucleus of cells. And under no circumstances could I manage to get P50 and BCL3 co-expressed and find them out in the cytoplasm. So the next slide, and I think coming to, next slide, thank you. So I'm coming to a conclusion. P50 activity is regulated by a number of different things, and those include proteolytic processing, IKappa-B CTR. This is the carboxy terminal region, which is an IKappa-B. I didn't go into it, but the carboxy terminal region of P50, of the P105, is also expressed as a separate protein here. So the P105 locus gives rise to two proteins, IKappa-B CTR and P105. P105 is processed to this. IKappa-B CTR, shown by Xu-Chi Liu in the lab, is capable also of inhibiting the DNA binding of P105 and interacting. So the IKappa-B found at the carboxy terminus of P105 has both a cis and a trans ability to inhibit the DNA binding and affect NF-kappa-B function, P50 function. Proteolytic processing gives rise to, somehow, P50 homodimers, which go into the nucleus. In the nucleus now, we imagine that BCL3 and P50 are interacting, and that phosphorylation plays a role in how P50 interacts with BCL3 and binds to DNA. The story is going to get much more complicated because we know that under some circumstances, BCL3 can bind to P50 even when it's bound to DNA, certain types of DNA binding sites, and it can, we think, affect its function there. The next slide. So in conclusion, then, we have a number of different genes which constitute NF-kappa-B. The major question that I asked at the beginning is how does a single transcription factor affect a number of different cellular functions? The answer is that it's not a single transcription factor. It probably is constituted of a family of transcription factors, each of which apparently can heterodimerize with another. Presumably then each binding upon heterodimerization, having the ability to bind different types of DNA. The story then becomes more complicated by the fact that there are multiple IKappa-Bs, each of which then are modulating differentially these activities. And that you have two different gene families here, the IKappa-Bs and the RELs meeting in the middle here in a convergence of the two gene families in what I like to call an evolutionary marriage of convenience. Here, the last slide shows, in fact, that you can use cellular immunology for molecular biology. This reads Ware, Herzenberg, Black, I think, and Herzenberg. And the last slide, these are the people who contributed. Martin Scott, formerly actually of Irv Weissman's group, did a lot of the work with me on the nuclear localization, the stainings, which was done. Xuqi Liu was responsible for the carboxy terminus of P105 work. Takashi Fujita and I worked together on the transcriptional activation. Me and this work was done in the laboratory of David Baltimore. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions or comment? Hi.
Okay, it all depends upon the type of sequence to which the homodimers or heterodimers bind. So it's not easy to make a simple scaling statement as to which is better than another. What we can say is that P65 does have a transactivating domain, which is present in the carboxy terminal most domain. P50 has a transactivating domain, which is actually found in the middle of the REL domain in a sequence which is not present in P65. There's actually an insertion in the P50 domain. But that apparently P50's ability to open up that transactivating domain, even when it's bound to P65, I didn't show the information, the data which suggests this is the case, really depends upon the sequence to which it binds. So there's a much more subtle level of interaction, that it's not just the DNA binding site to which you, or it's not whether or not you bind to the DNA, it's also what type of DNA that you bind to, which regulates whether or not there's transcriptional activation. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, so Sue's question is, yeah. Sue's question is whether or not we can simply just transfect the cDNAs containing each of these, which will express each of these different REL proteins, or presumably also transfect mutants of these things. And the reason why we can't do that, and the reason why it confounds the studies, is because when you transfect, for instance, P65, P65 is the receptor for IKappa-B. So what you'll end up doing is sopping up all of the available IKappa-B and releasing the NF-kappa-B, which is already endogenously expressed. And other things which happen is then that P65 will bind to any REL proteins which might be available, even though it's not the physiologic partner for P65, and also mess up the studies. I did all of these results, and I showed them at group meeting, and David said, stop it. Because this is the reason, you know, we just can't do these because you can't form a firm conclusion from it. And I have to agree that that's the case. And it's only under limited circumstances that I dare show transfection studies. But it's just not possible. I wish that I could do it that way. But
more questions? Yes.
Yeah, I give a lot of excuses.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
In the nucleus, yeah. Well, we spent about a year wondering about this and came up with a number of potential answers. But P50 does have both repressive and activating functions. So you don't want to have all of the available P50 in the nucleus at the same time. So what we think is that the P105 is acting as a reservoir. And that under certain circumstances, it can be induced to associate with other rel domains, or that it can be induced to be proteolyzed. We would like to believe that the proteolysis effect, the proteolysis event, is an induced event. So what the P105, in fact, Patrick Barley just showed this in a recent cell paper, what the function of the IKappa B domain in P105 is to reach around, bind to the rel domain, and hide the nuclear localization signal. And he did, through a number of studies, he showed that if you delete away a certain portion of that domain, the ankyrin domain, then the resulting mutant protein can migrate to the nucleus. Why it bothers to associate with BCL3 once it's in the nucleus, my only guess is that P50 is not truly a constitutive activator or repressor, but that it's a modulated activator or repressor. And that there are going to be kinases in the nucleus. In fact, I didn't show the study, but dephosphorylation of BCL3 will inhibit its ability to inhibit P50. So that there's now evidence mounting that BCL3 is also going to be a modulated protein. My guess is that within the next year, what we're going to find is that IKappa B is also present in the nucleus of cells. And that the reason why IKappa B could go to the nucleus of the cells is that if you think about it, NF-kappa B is an induced response. And you have to have a way of turning off an induction event. So one of the things that might happen is that NF-kappa B goes to the nucleus. When IKappa B is produced, if it doesn't find NF-kappa B out there, it heads into the nucleus to find it and to rip it off the DNA and basically stop the induction event. And those are the types of things that I think we're going to find as the answers to the question. Sorry, Noko. I don't want to say that yet. BCL3, I know, is. And I don't want to say anything about the other ones yet. I mean, IKappa B, as classically defined, can be found in the cytoplasm of cells associated with P5065. I mean, that's how the model went. But I don't want to say anything about where IKappa B is found later. I think that you're going to find that some of them are also found in the nucleus. Yeah.
Please use the microphone, yeah.
I may have missed a little bit of the story. You said that in the band shift assay, you needed to delete a piece of P65 to allow binding for
efficient binding. DNA binding.
Yeah. On the other assay you used, you didn't need to do that.
Which other assay?
Bromodeoxyuridine binding
right.
to the label
right.
to the label mm-hmm. oligo, and then use STS page
right.
analysis,
mm-hmm.
and you had efficient binding of P65 by
mm-hmm.
itself.
Mm-hmm. Right. So there's inefficient binding when you do the gel shift, but there is an apparent efficient binding when you do cross linking, and the reason why that we think that's the case is because the cross-linking is a capture assay. So when P65 binds to the DNA, which has got a cross-linkable probe to it, it's then captured. So the on-off rate then essentially isn't the same as what you see in a simple gel shift. So that basically anything which binds to the DNA then is captured. This is the same reason why you can't use these cross-linking probes in whole nuclear extracts, because so many things will bind, although only transiently to DNA, everything will get picked up and you get an ugly mess. So this is using purified protein, which is why we can do these studies.
So actually, your model would be changed in the anchoring repeat will change the affinity to the DNA of masking DNA.
There's not an anchoring repeat in P65, but ankyrin does inhibit the DNA binding in cis of P50 to DNA, and you have to remove it before it'll bind to DNA.
Yes, the other domain. I'm
the
sorry.
Other domain, yeah. It modulates. In fact, it's more complicated than that. P65 does have a low affinity to almost any type of DNA, and I've shown this pretty conclusively. And that when you remove then the carboxy terminus of P65, it loses that low affinity DNA binding ability and picks up the specificity. So what probably is happening is that 65 is coming together and forming the heterodimer. but it's not forming the right heterodimer. All right, it's not forming the correct association. And it seems to be able to associate with any type of DNA. You can label any piece of DNA and 65 will bind to it, although with much lower affinity.
Just a Okay, Takeshi.
Not that we've seen in immunoprecipitation assays so far. Well, these studies were all done, I think this is Warner Green's data. And what Warner Green does is he binds P50, basically purified P50 from bacteria to a column and then runs CFOS over it, purified CFOS over it. And he says that he sees binding. I don't know whether to believe it. Maybe it's the case. But I think it's, at this point, premature because there's no biological basis, and he certainly hasn't shown a complex in cells. In fact, there's no other complex of REL proteins that have been shown in cells except for a CREL50 heterodimer. But all the other genes are known to exist, but no function can be ascribed to them. So I would be wary about that at the time being. Targeting to where? It's being done. No information yet.
Okay, Len?
So there are some real pitfalls, I guess, in doing this kind of association studies, because you're doing it at some particular kind of concentration of all the reagents, particular perhaps. One of the things that's been confusing us, maybe confusing, maybe not confusing us, is the concentration of DTT that that's being used. And you can see differences with Warner Green's findings and ones that are coming up in our lab now based upon that. So the question basically is, how do you know by binding assays what's the physiologically relevant medium in which to do it?
Yeah. Well, it is a problem. In fact, sometimes when we don't see DNA binding for a factor that we're looking for, the answer is, well, try more binding conditions. You know, change the binding conditions. So there is no answer to what you're saying.
Well, I mean, the in vivo would be nice if that works, but you pointed out why it doesn't. So because of all these other REL proteins, which can come in as soon as you have something which inhibits something. And then the kinetics is not there. It's very difficult to figure out what the kinetics of binding would be and what the kinetics then of transcription beginnings would be. So I guess this is a very complicated area and probably take years to finally figure out what's going on at a physiological level.
The only thing I think that we've tried to do when looking at the activities that one sees in vivo or in vitro is to find exact correlates between what we see in vitro and what we see in vivo. And only then do I feel comfortable drawing a conclusion. And this is the reason why with the CFOS stuff, yes, it might be, but until there's a reason why it should be expected in vivo, I'm not going to jump on that bandwagon.
I just want to say, Gary, that none of this detracts from the absolutely beautiful analysis that you've presented. And, clearly, progress is being made very rapidly. Very nice.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Gary.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Dr. Mark Noble, who'd like to show some pictures. And the title of his talk is Precursor Biology, Regeneration, and Tissue Repair.
So do we have any? Okay, very good, thank you. I have to do a little technical rearrangement.
Coffee break?
So, well, while we're setting this up, I just want to say thank you to my old friend Ko for this opportunity to come to this beautiful country. This is my first visit to Japan, and I hope that there'll be many more. That I only I'm delighted that between Co and Professor R.I. that I'm going to get a chance to have a bit of a look around and meet some colleagues here. I hope that that'll be extended several times in the future. The, you know, you're, this, we have so much to be thankful to, for to Len and Lee. I mean, one of the things that I'm certainly most grateful for is the way that they've demonstrated time and again how you can build a family of such remarkable individuals coming out of the lab. I don't know of any other festschrift that I've been to that has had so many distinctive personalities all contributing interesting, important findings. This is, you know, your memory is funny, that I really thought that this film about the cell sorter was totally off the wall because I didn't think it had anything to do with the real history of the cell sorter. And Gary, I totally disagree with what you say about Lynn's engineering abilities because I remember something totally different. You can't see this very well, but this is something that my wife Barbara Himes and I have made as a present for Len. And see, what I remember is, I remember Len coming out of Caltech and being knowing something about magnetism and electricity and Maxwell's demon and things like this. So this is, you can look at this later. This is a sieve. It's connected to batteries. There's a magnet over here that's pulling cells out into two streams. There was a tremendous power with supplying energy to move the cells, but the animal house was so good, they were able to train rodents to jump up and down on pasture pipettes, passing the cells out, which Len illuminates with a flashlight. And this is actually my very clear memory of the early days of the cell sorter. I mean, perhaps, so this is our birthday present to you, my friend. So we can turn this off and turn on the slides, and let me tell you about, if we can turn, can we turn the slides on, please, and we'll turn this off. So it's kind of, it's a certainly a little funny for me to be here because I was never Lennon Lee's graduate student. In fact, I only met them for the first time yesterday. But yeah, that I was, that's right. But I was an adopted member of the lab. I've never actually worked on immunology, but it turns out that a lot of the projects seem to have come together in coincidental ways. What I'm interested in is how are you going to repair tissues? I'm totally convinced that within the working lifetimes of many of us, it will be standard medical procedure to carry out tissue repair in many organs through either precursor transplantation or increasing enhancement of our ability to promote the growth of precursors that are resident in tissue. So how are we going to improve the odds of getting to this very desirable state of affairs? And what has seemed to me is that the way to do it, of course, is to study precursor biology, either to learn how to grow cells so that you can transplant them or to understand the factors that control their proliferation in normal tissue. The tissue where we've worked the most is the nervous system, and you can frame the sorts of questions that we're interested in the nervous system in some fairly specific ways. The nervous system starts as a small group of homogeneous appearing cells that goes on to diversify and form all the cell types of the nervous system. And we'd like to understand how that diversification occurs. What are the relationships between cells? What are the signals that cause cells to go one way or another? How do cells interpret signals? You start with a very small structure going on to a very large structure. And we'd like to understand not only how division is controlled, but perhaps more importantly for our interests, how terminal differentiation, the cessation of division, is achieved. Because I think good arguments can be made that it is this failure to achieve terminal differentiation that is perhaps the key lesion leading on to neoplasia. Okay, now because I am talking in the nervous system, and very few of you have any working experience in neurobiology, I think I better remind you of the cell types I'm interested in. The next slide, please, is a color electron micrograph of the nervous system of a politician. It's a very simple nervous system. One neuron, which people know about neurons, they send messages to their target organs. But there's other cell types in the nervous system, which from the point of view of a cell biologist are in fact far more interesting. There's oligodendrocytes. These are the cells that wrap myelin sheets around axons, very critical function. There's astrocytes, which are the major cell type in the nervous system, and they have all sorts of functions. They provide substrates for axonal outgrowth. They provide trophic substances. For example, this astrocyte is extracting ham from the capillaries and converting it to hamburgers, which is also known as neurotrophin 6. It's been cloned by Genentech. Hamburgers are major trophic factor for neurons, we believe. Anyway, these are the cell types that I'm interested in, are the astrocytes and the oligodendrocytes. And the next slide, please. Now, this is what we want to get beyond. This is a summary of current approaches to treating neurological disease. And it's a very undesirable state of affairs. And one of the problems that I'm really focused most attention on is this particular one of myelin repair. Because in the normal axon, having a myelin sheath around the axon allows impulses to move very efficiently and very rapidly along the nerve. But in certain diseases, such as multiple sclerosis, these sheaths are broken down. The effects of this are shown in the next slide. And it's a very serious problem. Now, to start out on this work, when I was a postdoc in Martin Raff's lab, we decided to simplify our studies by working in a simple system. And the next slide, please. And the system we chose is the optic nerve. And the reason we chose to work on the optic nerve is because all the cell bodies that have their axons running through the nerve have the bodies are located elsewhere. So you can do a very simple dissection and now get a preparation of glial cells, astrocytes and oligodendrocytes, that you can study in a much more simplified culture system. Okay, next slide, please. Okay. So the start of our work came at a time when I decided to purify astrocytes. This was a time when the view in neurobiology that to work on glial cells was a sure sign of cell death, that this was a graveyard, and I just reasoned that you can't have 90% of the cells in the brain be boring, and people had done the wrong experiments. So I set out to purify astrocytes. We started studying their biology. And then as we did this work, Martin Raff and I came to notice that in optic nerve cultures, there were two very clear different kinds of astrocytes. There were some that looked like the ones on the top with a large cell body, a large nucleus. These are the kind that purified from cortex. There was another type that had a small cell body, a small nucleus, lots of processes. We could label them with different antibodies, and we called them type 1 and type 2 astrocytes. Same slide, please. Okay. The surprising result came when we found that type 2 astrocytes and oligodendrocytes were derived from a single bipotential progenitor cell, the oligodendrocyte type 2 astrocyte, or O2A progenitor, which was the first precursor defined in the central nervous system, and I think has become one of the most elegant systems for studying bipotential, or as I'll tell you later, tripotential differentiation. There's two very different differentiation mechanisms that occur in this lineage. The pathway to the oligodendrocyte is a default pathway. That is to say, this cell knows how to become an oligodendrocyte. It doesn't need any signals from the environment to do that. But to become a type 2 astrocyte, it absolutely requires inducive signals. So you can study two different kinds of differentiation in this precursor. The cell also needs signals from the environment to divide. And what we found was that type 1 astrocytes secrete a mitogen, which we later identified to be platelet-derived growth factor, which drives the division of these O2A progenitor cells. Next slide, please. Okay, so now we had defined the cell types in the nerve. We'd learned to grow them. We'd identified basic cell-cell interactions involved in the vision. And we could start to study some of the more interesting problems in development. Now, one of the problems we've been very interested in is timing. In courtship, in sport, just as in development, timing is everything. And if you look in organ after organ after organ, animal after animal, you see particular cell types coming up at particular times. Well, this is absolutely extraordinary, and one would like to understand how it occurs. Within the optic nerve, we knew first from Bob Miller and Martin Raff's work that type 1 astrocytes come up at about embryonic day 16. At day 21, the day of birth in the rat, you first see oligodendrocytes, and about 8 to 10 days after birth, you start seeing cells with the antigenic characteristics of type 2 astrocytes. Rochelle Small and I then showed that the O2A progenitors first enter the nerve from a germinal zone elsewhere in the nervous system at about embryonic day 16, and they're present in the nerve, seemingly as a dividing population, for several days before they start producing oligodendrocytes. Now, the first clue to oligodendrocyte timing came from the observations we made when we learned how to get these progenitors to divide. When we did our original experiments, we found that putting progenitors in culture was associated with differentiation of all cells within 3 days, even though in the animal, these cells were going to divide extensively for weeks and produce oligodendrocytes for weeks. When we grew them on astrocytes, we now found that progenitors would divide and make oligodendrocytes for a long period of time. Martin Raff and colleagues then extended these results to show that if you take embryonic optic nerve cells and put them on astrocyte monolayers, they now make oligodendrocytes at precisely the right time. The next slide, please. And we did, Martin and I then showed together that if you take platelet-derived growth factor and give that to embryonic optic nerve cells, you again get oligodendrocytes at precisely the right time. So if there's no mitogen, then at 2 days in culture, you have oligodendrocytes. But in the presence of just a little bit of PDGF, at day two, there's none. At day three, there's none. And the first ones appear on day four, just as they would in the animal. So just by adding a simple mitogen, we've reconstituted the complex timing of development in a tissue culture dish. And the timing works perfectly. If you take an embryonic day 18 animal, after day three, you have oligodendrocytes. Embryonic day 19 animal, after 2 days. Next slide, please. We think this timing works through a biological clock. That you've heard about one biological clock, the one that measures fibroblast senescence. There's lots of clocks in biology. The hemoglobin shift is probably the one that you're all the most familiar with. Within this lineage, what we do know can happen is that an individual dividing progenitor can divide a limited number of times before all members of a clonal family synchronously differentiate into non-dividing oligodendrocytes. And you can watch this under time lapse, where you start out with a single dividing progenitor here. Because these cells are very motile, they'll fill the wall with 3 or 4 divisions. If one member of the family starts changing its shape and becoming an oligodendrocyte, within hours, every clonal relative is doing the same thing, even though you can have cells from other families dividing around in the same geography. So it's not contact, it doesn't look like a diffusible signal, it looks like an internal mechanism. We're starting to know a little bit about how it works. I'm not going to have time to mention that. If anyone wants to talk about it later, I'll be happy to tell you what we're starting to learn. The next slide, please. Okay. Now, when you give cells PDGF, you elicit a complex behavior from them. You get a particular bipolar morphology. The cells are motile. They express particular antigens. When they differentiate into oligodendrocytes, they drop out of division. So a simple hypothesis is that to get this complex program, all you need to do is put these cells into division. That turns out to be incorrect. In the next slide, if we give these cells fibroblast growth factor, now they turn into multipolar cells. These red ones here are O2A progenitors that still divide, but instead of dividing with an 18-hour cell cycle, now they have a 45-hour cell cycle. They don't migrate, and you can't see, but I'll tell you that when they turn into oligodendrocytes, they continue to divide. So these growth factors that we think of as mitogens are not only controlling cell division, they're eliciting highly specific differentiation programs from these cells. Next slide, please. But our most interesting result with growth factors came when we added PDGF and FGF together. And then we found that these cells become trapped in a self-renewal loop from which they cannot escape. And they will divide in culture, but to a cell biologist is forever. Which is to say, we've been able to grow these cells continuously for well over a year just by having two mitogens present. There's no spontaneous immortalization in the culture. The cells can differentiate normally. If we remove a growth factor, they differentiate normally. I'll tell you a little bit more about the normality of the cells, but I just want to make a comment about the possible relevance of this to thinking about neoplasia. That, as we've heard, that one thinks of neoplasia as having different gene types of genes cooperating. There's the immortalizing genes, which allow cells to grow forever. There's also the growth control genes, the RAS family genes, which control cell division. What we are saying is that cooperation between two growth control genes is as effective as immortalizing cells as any activated oncogene we have ever looked at. And whether this is occurring in neoplasia is something, of course, we're very interested in. Okay, next slide, please. Now, what the being able to grow cells like this allows us to achieve one of our long-time goals of trying to repair damaged tissue. And what we've done here is to enrich O2A progenitors, grow them in culture for 3 weeks. 3 weeks is chosen as a fairly arbitrary time because it's the length of time that you grow keratinocytes from human skin for transplantation onto burn victim patients. So it's a time period that's where it's accepted that you can have in vitro growth and then go into a human animal model. Anyway, in collaboration with Bill Blakemore at Cambridge, we use the lesion system where the spinal cord of the rat is irradiated and a little bit of ethidium bromide is injected. This kills all the cells with DNA in the region of the injection. So all you have left in that region is axons. And because you've irradiated the animal, you get no host repair. Bill Blakemore had shown that if you inject heterogeneous populations, you can get some repair. And together we've shown, which is shown in the next slide, that we can grow our O2A progenitors and inject them, and we can remyelinate 90 to 95% of the axons in a region of demyelination. So this is normal myelin down here. We could focus this a bit, perhaps. These thick black sheaths are normal myelin. These axons are surrounded by very thin myelin sheaths capable of remyelination. So we've achieved one of our goals of being able to repair damaged tissue in one of the most complex tissues of the body. And I should also say that it looks like this principle of growth factor cooperation leading to prolonged precursor self-renewal is beginning to smell like a general phenomenon. Hematopoietic stem cells from Mike Dexter's experiment seem to behave the same way. There's indications on neuroblasts that similar rules might apply there. Next slide, please. Let's skip the, go on to the next slide. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Okay, we'll skip that. That just shows that you can also genetically engineer these cells and clone them. But what I want to get to now is the adult animal, because it's all very well to grow precursors and transplant them, but we'd also like to understand how to enhance repair within a tissue. And to do that, you have to understand the biology of the cells that are present in adult tissue. And there's no reason to think that they're the same as the ones that are present during development. In fact, there's a lot of good reason to think that they may not be. But no one had studied that very much. So when Huss Walswijk joined the lab as a PhD student, I was very fortunate that this excellent young student was willing to take on the difficult project of working on progenitors in the adult nervous system. When we work on these experiments are excruciating. From a single adult rat optic nerve, you get 1,000 precursor cells. And what I'll tell you about is based on experiments with all the levels of difficulty associated with that sort of work. But anyway, what we have found is that these cells are very different from the perinatal ones. They have different morphologies, they have different antigens, different division characteristics. Grown on astrocyte monolayers, the perinatal cells divide every 18 hours, the adult cells every 65 hours. The perinatal ones migrate rapidly, the adult ones migrate slowly. So we suggest that there's an adult-specific precursor cell. That leads to several questions immediately. When does this cell appear? Where does it come from? How is it maintained in the tissue? In the next slide, what Huss found is that the first adult-like cells appear at 7 days after birth, and in the period between 7 days and 1 month after birth, there's a transition in the nerve with the perinatal-like cells disappearing and adult-like cells coming to predominate. But in this intervening period, the these cells appear to live happily together. So it does not look as though there's some hormonal shift that comes through the nervous system saying, okay, guys, grow up, time to be an adult progenitor. Something more interesting is going on. So we went in at this time point, at 3 weeks, and just filmed progenitors dividing and differentiating. The next slide, please. And what we found was that we could identify founder cells, which at the first division would give rise to bipolar, rapidly dividing, rapidly migrating cells. I guess it's up in focus on the top. And at later divisions,